next session is the future of power distribution companies in the context of content and carriage, regulatory assets, legacy issues, financial health and discoms, USO, and impact on open access. Now, I myself have worked in distribution company for nearly 25 years. And in fact, I had started this company in Greater Noida called Noida Power Company Limited. I was the president of the company. And I find, a lot of people, we recently had a conference in Calcutta the other day. We were discussing what ails the distribution companies, why the discoms are in such a state of affairs. And the general consensus was politics matters, and political interference has been one of the major reasons for the problems that the discoms are facing. If you look at Noida also, Noida Power Company, very small distribution company, which was started in 93 or so. And now I find today they are making good profit. They have a small area, they have the license. Whereas side by side, I do not know the discoms in UP, they are facing problems. So I always say where there is a will, there is a way. And where there is no will, there is no way. So maybe the political will is required more to keep the energy sector running. You know, that's what we failed in Calcutta the other day, last week. And we were thinking how to create a political mandate. We don't know how to create a political mandate. May I now request the panelists of the session two to kindly come up and take their seats. Dr. Pramod Deo, former chairman CERC. Dr. Deo, kindly. Mr. Arun Goyal, principal secretary power, government of Goa. Mr. Goyal. Mr. O.P. Gupta, MD, MSc, DCL. Mr. O.P. Gupta, nice to have you, sir, Mr. Gupta, after seeing you in Windsor. You're there in Windsor, were you not? Yes. Mr. Ajay Mehta, Commissioner, Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. Mr. R.R. Mehta, CEO, Mumbai Distribution Business, Reliance Infrastructure Limited. Mrs. B. Neena, Director, Distribution and Safety, KACB. Mr. Ajay Shankar, former Member Secretary, National Manufacturing Competitive Council. Mr. Ajay Shankar, sir, please. Like the session one, we would like this to be in the form of a panel. Sir, you are the chairman of the session. And if you could restrict, if panelists could speak, say about 5 minutes each. So we spend more time on interactive sessions. So over to you, sir.
Thank you. Since we are going to give 5 minutes each, I think only some very important points could be made. And we are now talking about the distribution sector. And in fact, the entire conference is going to revolve around what ails distribution sector and what needs to be done. And we also have a proposed amendments to the Act, which really talks about separation of carriage and content. But I think how the open access, all these issues are there. But the very important thing before we start this session, I would like to remind, because Ajay Mehta, in 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, had made this presentation about MSCBs, now it is MSCDCLs, how the revenue comes from different consumers. Now that's very interesting, those numbers, because we find that MSCB, the MSCDCL, has 2 crore, 1 lakh some consumers who contribute just less than 50%. And all the HT industry, HT commercial, and if you take railways, they are also contributing almost the same. And their number comes to something like 21,000. So question is that if you are talking of open access, carriage and content separation, if these, all these consumers go, who is going to cross-subsidize 2 crore, 1 lakh consumers? Now, these 2 crore, 1 lakh consumers include your agriculture consumers. And as you know, that number of pump sets that we have in Maharashtra. So question is the political one. So I don't know whether anybody has thought of it. Even the Kirith Somaiya Committee, after that they have done, what the states have said that no, we can't do it immediately, we'll do it after 5 years. But even after 5 years, how are you going to address this? So that is I think, the crux of the problem. We have to understand that when we talk about, because when we, it's very easy to say that we will reform the distribution sector. Because we made a wrong assumption in the 2003 Act, where we said that the regulator shall eliminate cross-subsidy, which was amended in 2005 because of the left party pressure. And we said that we will gradually reduce. So subsidy will be given only to small consumers. But now the reality remains is that we have not been able to do that. And even if you see the average billing for industrial consumers, that HT consumers, is more than 8 rupees. And these 2 crore, 1 lakh consumers, their average billing rate is only 4 rupees. And out of those 4 rupees, again, if you were to take out the agriculture, I think tariff must be 1 rupee, 50 paisa maximum. So we have really a political problem. Are the politicians willing to forgo the subsidy? And who's going to do that? I think that is the main issue.
Having the choice to move from one to other at least once a year. In fact, this presentation is, I don't know, loaded. I am just speaking on that. This can be shut down. So the issue of power purchase planning, how do you do power purchase planning? Because if people move 1 year from one licensee to other licensee, most of the power purchase agreement in the current system are long-term power purchase agreements. So this issue was discussed in the morning. How do you get out of those power purchase agreements? Then the supply licensees not having long-term purchases with them, what happens to the standby power arrangements? Because even today, lots of cases, the situation is coming up where the open access consumers are required to have a standby arrangement with DISCOMs. So that is an issue which needs to be addressed. Loss apportionment, that is another issue which needs to be looked into. Because today, the system losses are there. Most of them today get directly apportioned to the distribution licensee. When there will be multiple supply licensees in the system, what kind of, apart from the wheeling part of it, which can be attributed to the wire business part of it, what happens to other losses, which invariably we talk about either theft or leakages in the system. Load shedding situations where one supply licensee's power supplier trips, what happens to the system then? So all those kind of things will need to be certainly looked into when we are talking about the separation of the business. Financial position, as I said, supply licensee, they being in a, you know, to be run more commercial basis, what we see in Mumbai, and those kind of things, they will be certainly in a much, much better position in case they are able to recover their costs. But incumbent supply licensees' financial future remains a big question mark. And for how long? Finally, the legacy issues which will come while separating the system. What happens to the existing regulatory assets? How they get apportioned? What happens to the accumulated losses? What happens to the revenue gaps which are already coming in the system? So all these issues, both sides need to be settled before this amendment comes in operation. But in the long term, I think personally, my personal view is that carriage and content separation in a longer run will bring efficiencies to the system, certainly will bring more accountability in the system, and probably in a longer run, maybe over a period of 10 years or 15 years, will certainly be helpful for the system. Now the last part, which the chairman asked me how it happened in Maharashtra, that the industrial tariffs come down, and of course, my predecessor, Mr. Mehta, will be the person to tell about how all this happened, that Maharashtra is load shedding free. Revenue part of it, all I can say is that regulators in Maharashtra over a period of time have been more responsible. If you see the numbers which Mr. Goyal gave, 83 paisa gap, it certainly not has been there for most of the time in Maharashtra. From 2005 onwards, consistently annual tariff revision most of the time has taken place. The current tariff order which was running was based on 2012 tariff, but the regulators did provide for certain energy charges to be passed on in terms of additional energy charges by way of regulatory process in between as well. And therefore, most of the costs which were getting recovered in time, they also, you know, help that this year when we did prepare our ARR loss reduction, which has happened over a period of years, certain efficiencies which did come in the system, and the cost of power purchase, which was anticipated and which actually incurred because of power planning and better, I'll say, load management techniques in the system, ultimately help reduce the ARR to some extent. That benefit specifically was passed on to the industry, because industrial tariffs in Maharashtra was on the much higher side as compared to the rest of the country. And regulators, again, have been little more, I'll say, bold, in the sense that even in this tariff order, where the industrial tariff is being reduced, simultaneously unmetered agriculture tariff has been increased. And certain rationalization of even residential tariffs has taken place. To that extent, even Maharashtra political class has been much more understanding and supportive that the sector, and they understand the fact that this sector is a very important sector. Until unless it is made financially viable, it is impossible to run a state like Maharashtra, and ultimately political repercussions will come back to them. So these are the reasons, I suppose. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta. I would request Mr. Ajay Mehta, who is now Municipal Commissioner, Mumbai, and he has been in the power sector for a long time. In fact, my career and his career have run in parallel. So I would request him that he can give his views with the new proposed amendments. How does he see the sector developing?
Thank you, sir. In fact, I still continue with the power sector, but a very thin slice. BEST comes under the corporation, but of course, it's a much better managed institution than the other power sector. And what Harry has done today is the shotgun approach. In fact, he's got the future, the carriage content, legacy issues. He's got a whole lot of issues. So it's like a shotgun approach. Something would work. Just quickly, because I have 5 minutes, so I'll just raise 5 issues. First, legacy. Historically, we have told this nation, infrastructure, government knows best. So we are grappling with that psychological mindset, ki private sector wo kya janta hai, infrastructure, hame hi pata hai jo pata hai. And secondly, we've told everybody, because government knows best, government runs the infrastructure, therefore, even if you didn't pay for infrastructure, all is fine. So whether it's water, there I was grappling with electricity getting stolen or not being paid for. Here I'm in Bombay, we have about 37% to 40% of non-revenue water, where I don't know where that water is going. So water, electricity, roads, whatever, it is run by the government, it's free. Take it. If you feel like paying, do pay for it. That's the first legacy issue that you're grappling with. And that has led to the current problem. If you ask me, the current problem centers around only one issue, one simple issue. There is no cash in the system. If there is no cash in the system, there is no way that the system can flourish and grow. Cash is the lubricant for any system. The lubricant is gone. The cash has simply evaporated. So neither can you get your generation in place, nor can you expand distribution, nor can you distribute more power. Your transmission is suffering. Cash has disappeared. And cash has disappeared due to various reasons. I won't indulge in those. It's because of losses. It's because of people not wanting to pay. Because of subsidies, a whole lot of issues. But fundamentally, the bottom line is there is no cash in the system. That's the second. Third, is suddenly we decided one fine morning that government does not know best. Let's start getting the private sector in. So we had a bidding process. We got those bids. And now we landed up with another problem. How do you interpret these contracts? So there's seminars after seminars, court cases after court cases trying to interpret this contract. Can a contract be opened? Can it not be opened? Can Indian coal be substituted with foreign coal? Can I pay a compensatory tariff? Can I not pay? So the whole sector has now moved away from providing electricity to providing jobs for lawyers. So now you have these whole contract issues which are opened up. Everybody is trying to find a solution. We really don't know what the solution is. Now with these three problems, we've ended up with a fourth problem. And the fourth problem is the solution itself. The solution itself is a problem. So what's the solution we thought of? We said, okay, let's have open access. What did you do in open access? Cherry pick. Yaar, jo pay karne wala customer hai, usko kaise to bhi pakad lo. Aur jo non-pay karne wala, usko bhul jao. One solution. Second solution, then somebody said, nahi yaar, this is too In Marathi, there's a word called too ugad. Ugad is exact English, too open. It's too like, it's like there, yeah? Everybody knows that you're trying to pick up the best cars. So let's devise something much better. So they said, okay, let's separate carriage from content. भाई पहले तो आपने हमको कहा कि जनरेशन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ट्रांसमिशन अलग कर दीजिए, सोल्यूशन आ जाएगा. कर दिया हमने. आप कहते हैं साहब डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन को भी ना आप कैरेज और कंटेंट अलग कर दीजिए. अच्छा भाई कर देते हैं. देन स्लोली व्हाट विल हैपन कि कंटेंट जो है उसमें वी विल ब्रेक इट अप टू पेइंग कंटेंट एंड नॉन पेइंग कंटेंट. सो जो पेइंग कंटेंट है दिस इज द इंडस्ट्री द हाई वैल्यू कंज्यूमर, उसको कैसे तो भी हम पकड़ लेंगे, और नॉन पेइंग कंटेंट छोड़ दो, कोई तो देखेगा उसको. So finally, we found a very polite way of saying that open access can slowly shift to carriage and content. And then we are finding another solution called franchisee. I experimented, Mr. Jayant Kavale experimented. A franchisee also, people are not keen on taking loss-making areas. They want the profit-making area. Everybody wants Pune. Nobody wants Bhiwandi. So again, is that the solution? So the solution itself has now become a problem for the sector. And what is the solution? I really do not know. So last issue, what is the future of this sector? The only thing I can say is, now Harry walks in very threateningly. So all I can say is, don't despair. Finally, I don't know where Mr. Devdutt Patnaik is, the interpreter of Hindu mythology. Finally, let's all remember that we believe in the concept of being born and dying, birth and death goes on. So these distribution companies will be dead sometime, but then this age we were monkeys, maybe the next time we are born, we'll be human beings. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Ajay Mehta. I would request Mr. R.R. Mehta, and he is now the CEO of Mumbai Distribution Company, and he has experienced parallel licensee and the problem that they are facing. So I'm sure that he will be able to throw light on this new approach.
It's always difficult to be the speaker after Ajay Mehta speaks. You know. What I would like to mention is that we have talked about yesterday about accountability. We have talked about citizen being converted into consumer. And of course, in the changing environment where the consumer who could be denied electricity is a demanding consumer that I want electricity. Now, under those circumstances, with whatever has been stated, that we are in the midst of confusion, in the midst of no solution. What is it? There are no timelines. There are no timelines of accountability. So what I would want to go through is just the slide in quick succession and just talk about one or two bullets on each. This is just what we are in Mumbai. We are serving one of the reliable, one of the losses area, so I won't delve too much on it. This presentation would be available if anybody wants to have it. It'll be more than this isn't what value-added consumer services we are providing. I'll again not go too much into it. This is what how we engage ourselves with the consumer on various platforms. This is what our technology use is in our managing the system. I'm skipping the contents. This is what we have done to bring down the losses, do technical intervention so that you know the access to the network is avoided. The one on the left hand side is what is being this time given award based on last year's best technological development award. This is again how we integrate our systems, various independent systems. This is on smart grid, where we are, the green dot show where we are, the diamond dot show where the world is. This is what our future of smart grid is, as to how we want to implement it and how we want to go forward in it. Now I come to the main issue. As Mr. Mehta correctly said, there's no cash. Where does the cash come from? It is from the consumer through the distribution into the entire value chain. Now what are the reasons why the cash is not coming are listed here. I'm not going to delve again into this. There's an issue of network, there's an issue of tariff, there's an issue of various losses. So how are we going to control it? Who is going to be accountable for it? Is it the distribution company? Is it the consumer? Is it the regulator? Is it the government? Is it the infrastructure like judiciary, police, who can, you know, when something is lodged, do they understand what the consequence of theft is? Many places, the special courts, although provided in the law, are not there. Special police stations are supposed to be there, they're not there. So it goes as a normal process of law, and it gets added to the volume of pending cases. And you know, the person is out on bail, he's back into his normal business of supplying electricity in an authorized manner. Now, Mr. Mehta mentioned about that, you know, there's a birth and rebirth, and that's exactly what is happening. There's an accumulation of losses, the government clears it. Again, there's an accumulation of losses, the government clears it. The cycle is continuing with no correction happening to it. And that's why I said the accountability, who is defining the accountability, and what is the timeline of that accountability is nowhere defined. Now, this reflects how the cost and the tariff variations are there, which results into the kind of accumulation of losses which we have seen in the previous slide as well. So this reflects inadequate tariff, results into accumulation, results into burden of interest, results into non-payment to various stakeholders, be it generator, be it somebody else. This is how the state DISCOMs debts have gone up. It's gone up by almost it's doubled in 4 years. And that's again because of, you know, not getting the tariffs, not getting the cash flows. So it's a situation what it is. This is these are the ones which are in the process, but they become a debt. In one way or the other, these are the various forms of the debts. No, they're servicing. Some are new. They've been, old debts have been converted into new, old outstanding have been converted into new. So there was an evolving process of transferring the timelines. Agencies and timelines, yes. With participation in some cases and compulsion of the state government to participate. In some cases, the banks are transforming. In some cases, the interest rebates are being given. So all kinds of mix and matches are being worked on. But if you don't get the tariff right, then all these will again slowly and gradually fall flat. FRP is a means. FRP is a means of financing. So it'll come into the tariff because the liability has to be met. The consumers. No, government has not taken over any liability. There's only a provision of 25% as a subsidy in case they meet their requirements of recovering the rest of the money. But the rest of the money has to come from the consumer. It is. They can't start. Who would be at the brunt of that? Okay. So this is just a reflection of, you know, the division of various states into various categorization of risk. This is what MOP study is as to where do the various DISCOMs lie into their risk and their ability to collect the money and, you know, the health structure of these DISCOMs. Now, these are all the stakeholders. I'm sorry, this is where, if you see the DISCOM is right in the center and everybody is around it, and DISCOM is the source of revenue generation for all these people. If there's a failure here, you're bound to have a consequential effect on the rest of the segments which are associated with it. Now, this is what is predicted in case the corrective actions are not taken as to where we would be in FY22. You see, we talked about accountability. there have been multiple committees which have suggested the ways and means to correct this situation. There have been directions from appellate tribunal, but they have not been implemented for various reasons, and I don't think I would want to get into the reasons because they would be socio-economic, political, everything is in it. So this was one of the committees. Another committee, appellate directives, another committee. This is all what has happened, understanding that there's a problem in DISCOMs, but no timelines, no committed implementation of the findings, and that's where we are, where we are. These are the five elements which are required to be addressed in case we want to move forward. Again, I say accountability, implementation is again an open issue. So it's, again, summary of the previous slide only. We need pricing reforms, efficiency in operation, yes. Regulatory reforms, infusion of private players, it's a questionable thing. Mr. Mehta is not too much towards it. And then obviously administrative support, like I said, judiciary, police, so that you know the curtailment of theft can be undertaken pretty efficiently. Well, that's about it. I won't go into career content separation, although there are slides behind it, but since it has already been spoken by Mr. Gupta, I would leave it with it. And the slides would be available in case anything is there. Please feel free to contact
me. What is your experience in Mumbai? You already have a kind of that.
No, I'm not against. Provided it is done in an effective manner and in a logical manner. Unfortunately, that logical manner is decided after the effectivity being done, and which is what causes the entire problem. Vesa, you mentioned about parallel licensing in Bombay. The experience has not been that good for the simple reason that there was no level playing field ever available, and nor is it being created so that they become competitive in each of the, each player becomes a competitive, and that's why there's a constant fight, there's a constant litigation, there's a constant reference to the regulator. So I would say it's not been a very healthy status. We are fighting, we are moving forward, but it can't be called a healthy environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mehta. I request MS Nina. She is the Director of Distribution and Safety, Karnataka State Electricity Board. Kerala. Only Kerala has a state electricity board.
Actually, we are still continuing as a single entity. That is why sir told that it is Kerala State Electricity Board now. Even though we are continuing as a single entity, actually, this is now Kerala State Electricity Board Limited, KEC Board. From public sector entity, now it has gone to a company, that's all. Actually, it came into, KCBL came into existence on 1st November 2013. Even now, we are continuing as a single bundled entity and doing generation, transmission, and distribution with three strategic business units having separate balance sheet and profit and loss account. All employees in the KCBL is with KCB is with the KCBL, and a master trust was established for meeting the pension liabilities. all regulatory assets was wiped off by revaluing the generation assets and land. We are having three directors, generation, transmission, and distribution, and also a finance director headed by CMD. By continuing as a single-bundled entity, we could do an effective and better coordination among generation, transmission, and distribution function, better financial control among SBUs, centralized material procurement. Actually, this is a better power system planning, and power procurement also is done centrally, so that long-term, medium-term, and short-term, because of this, overall optimization of the generation and power purchase process it is done actually. We are the entire procurer for the state, power generator and power procurer for the state, directly distributing 98% and 2% by small licensees. Average daily demand is around 63 MU. It's an annual increase of 6% is there, and the peak demand is around 3,800 megawatt. Our annual revenue requirement is 12,500 crore. This slide shows the growth of Kerala power system. This is the daily load curve of Kerala power system. Unlike other utilities, actually our peak off-peak variation is more than 50%, in whereas other utilities it is only around 20%. This is the category-wise consumption and revenue. Previously, the chairman sir was telling, see, our domestic consumption is around 50%, and they are giving only 30% of the revenue. HT, EHT, and bulk licenses actually contribute consuming 27%, and they are giving us around 35% of the 35% revenue. And LT commercial, which is only 13%, and that is actually contributes 25% of the revenue. Really, if that open access is coming, we are really afraid, because they can take directly. Now that corridor constraint is there, that is why now the people are not opting open access. Otherwise, definitely we'll end up in trouble. How KACB will meet the present energy requirements? See, KACB's internal hydel is only 30%. The rest, actually 45.79% from CGS and 19.65% from case on bits and traders. Expense, while coming to the expense components, the cost of power is around 56.5%, employee cost is around 16%, interest and finance charges around 13%, and other expense is only negligible actually. This is the prevailing tariff. See, our cost of supply is 5.80 rupees, and 50% of the consumption is done by domestic, and the average tariff for domestic is only 3.76 rupees. LT commercial, HT and EHT industries, LT commercial and small licenses only contributing more than the cost of supply. Even now for industrial, domestic and traction, etc., we are one among the lowest in the country. A key initiative taken by our organization is, actually by 2022, as per the energy survey, our peak demand will be plus 6,000 megawatt. So we have to own hydel capacity addition. Additional allocation from CEGS also have to be looked into. Power procured from renewables, establishing LNG-based power plants in the state, power procurement from generators outside the state through competitive bidding route, and establishing coal-based plant in the state. That so much of objection is there in establishing the coal stations. Anyway, we are trying to establish a coal thermal plant in Kasargod. The advantages of going in long-term basis is actually electricity demand is growing at the rate of 7 to 8% annually, and we are having only limited scope of new capacity addition. And from short-term market, non-reliability is there, and the price elasticity of short-term market during the shortages is from 16 to 20 rupees. And priority is also low for the short-term basis. And competitive price of electricity derived through bidding route in line with the cost of production. Then for optimizing the cost of generation, Actually, we have gone into a long-term procurement with a long-term MOU with the Maithon Power and Damodar Valley project. We have tied up 300 megawatt of Maithon Power at a CERC determined tariff with an indicative tariff of 3 rupees 72 paise. From Damodar Valley, the indicative tariff is 4 rupees 50 paise. Actually, through MOU route, we have tied up almost 550 megawatt. Two more slides only. See, design, build, finance, own and operate basis, two bids were called for, and 865 megawatt was tied up, and the average tariff is only 4 rupees 11 paise for this. And this is the first DISCOM in the country to tie up power through bidding route, and this is done by an empowered internal team. And in the span of 8 months, we have completed the bidding process. The loss, T&D loss of the KACB is, during 2001-2, it was around 30.76%, and by 2015, it has come down to 14.67%, which is equivalent to installing a 720 megawatt thermal plant. And 100% metering is there, and bills are issued also, and collection efficiency is around 99.9% without water authority. It is water authority is very poor in paying the bill. So apart from that, it is including that, it is around 98.5 to 98.8%. We are having a very good vigilance and APTS wing, and because of that good performance, theft and misuse of electricity has considerably reduced. We are having a very good IT team, and that billing software, HT billing software, accounting software, supply chain management software, HRIS, all these softwares are developed by in-house team with open source actually. And we are successful pilot implementation of e-office is complete, and the rolled out plan is, and the rolled out, and it is extending to other wing also. We are utilizing the manpower. And other initiatives are, we are having a separate wing for renewable energy and for their generation, and DSM activities also we are having a separate wing. For innovative ideas and new initiatives also we are having a separate wing. Past, to recover the past arrears also we are having a separate wing. And KACB, one of the few DISCOMs in the country, promptly repaying the power purchase dues. Optimization of generation, our aim is to continue contain the average cost of power purchase in and around 4 rupees. If we could achieve that, definitely we won't have to go for tariff revision for the next 2-3 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. I would request Mr. Ajay Shankar, he's the author of 2003 Act, and he has also seen the two main concepts in the 2003 Act. One was the open access, and the second was unbundling. And now we have a very good example of how Karnataka, Kerala, State Electricity Board, and Punjab, they have how unbundled. And now when we are moving to now carriage and content, I'm sure that you would like to draw from your past experience and suggest how we will move forward.
To begin with, I would like to strike a slightly more optimistic note, or bring in a more optimistic note in the discussions, because I was delighted hearing Mr. Gupta that in Maharashtra they have been able to get the tariff increases they needed, they are financially more comfortable than they were, and they have been able to lower industrial tariffs. Listening to discussions in the morning again, I felt a sense of great optimism that if we have roughly 40,000-45,000 megawatts of stressed, stranded assets, and the reported power shortages have come down to levels never heard before in India. So we are actually at a position where, with proper policy and management, the country could be genuinely free of power cuts on a sustainable basis. Now that is a huge, huge achievement. The other major achievement, which didn't come up and didn't get reported, was that between 2005 and 2014, in all the so-called less developed states, I think there has been a remarkable breakthrough in bringing electricity to households which were denied. So the World Bank report, which I was looking at yesterday, on the net, and it says that we have achieved 77.8% household access as in the year 2014. Now this compares to 57% in the 2001 census. So this is a huge breakthrough. And I genuinely believe that given the capacities created for supply of electricity, I think what the Prime Minister has said that we will take electricity to every household in 4 or 5 years can actually be done in about 3 years. Because that is the technological potential that the country has. Mr. Mehta said rightfully that cash is the problem. Now, here again, I see reasons for hope. And the reasons for hope flow from what has been happening elsewhere. So with the Aadhaar card and with direct cash transfer, we have for the first time the possibility of giving the farmer a cash card or an actual cash payment into his account and getting him to agree to metering of supply and getting him to agree to payment for metered supply on the basis of the cash transfers he gets. Now, the moment you achieve this, you will get more efficient use of electricity, you will get more efficient use of water, and you will be able to move towards 24-hour supply of electricity for agriculture to allow agriculture to make the transition to more productive modern agriculture. Because we are at a plateau on agricultural production because we can only flood our fields. And all the other things which we need to do with electricity in farms, we are unable to do because we are unable to supply electricity to farms 24 hours a day, and we are unable to do it because we want to give it free. And because we have been giving it free for so long, we cannot now charge. In fact, the Power Ministry lost, I think, 20 years in attempting to persuade state governments to charge farmers. In 2001 or so, when I was there, with great pride, we said that everybody is charging farmer except 3 states. And the clock turned back, and now Power Ministry recognizes the political reality that you cannot force states to charge farmers. So at best, you can try and persuade them to separate feeders. But I believe that we have come to a point where we can even leapfrog the separation of feeder syndrome by direct cash transfers to farmers and letting them make intelligent choices on how much electricity to consume and to pay more if they want to consume more. Similarly, on the issue of cross-subsidy, is seriously bring in a 1:2 ratio between peak and off-peak pricing. If you do that, then farmers who choose to use off-peak electricity will have to pay less, and the state government can give subsidies at that lower cost. So I would end by saying that I think lots of good things are in position. A little wisdom and sagacity, and 2-3 years, 4 years down the road, we could feel that we've really had a breakthrough in distribution. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajay. Before we throw it open for questions, I just like to add 2 things, because one thing is about the lifeline consumers and how to give them cheap power. In fact, FOR had done a study, and we came with the model regulation. And what we found is that that's not a problem at all. Because if you were to take all the old power purchase agreement, where the purchase costs are very low, and if you were to equitably distribute that, so all those consumers who are using less than 100 units will get covered. Their tariffs will be very low. You don't have to even give any subsidy from government. But the problem comes with more with the agriculture. We did another study. That study was done by FOIR, not FOR, Forum of Indian Regulators. And what that study showed is that the average cost of supplying to agriculture is the economic cost, is 2/3 of the average cost. Now, why it is the 2/3 of the average cost is because agriculture is supplied only for 7 to 8 hours. Now, it is not supplied for 24 hours for the simple reason your power system will not be able to take all the load. because the number of pump sets that you have, and if you were to run all the pump sets together, and especially that happens in the cropping season, according the kind of crops you are having, it will not be possible. So the demand on the system is less. That's why the cost, average cost, is becomes two-thirds. So that being the case, now this is a very difficult issue. Even if you want to do cash transfer, are you going to do the cash transfer to the all the important farmers who are nothing but the politicians who want the cash transfer? They can pay. Because in Maharashtra, there are 8 districts who contribute to agriculture demand. The feeder separation was mainly aimed at them. And they are growing sugarcane, vineyards, and bananas. So what are we talking about? Whom are we giving that cash transfer? In fact, it's the small and medium farmer who doesn't get the benefit of that irrigation. So this is a very political issue. So we should not just wish away that we will be able to solve it. It is a matter which the Prime Minister has to sit with Chief Minister and agree, and because this is what had happened. Because when the Electricity Act, Regulatory Commission Act came in 98, there was an agreement at the National Development Council on two things, that we will take the tariff setting out of the political purview, and then the agriculture tariff will be 50% of the average cost. And that did not happen, and today also it has not happened. Even if in Maharashtra, where we have been increasing agriculture tariff, it is far below than the cost of supply. So I think we will now invite questions.
The last speaker, Mr. Ajay Shankar, very beautifully put it. I'm a little confused because Dr. Deo said that you were the father of the Electricity Act, and I was lucky enough to be traveling around India with you as the father, along with the other father as well. The question I have is today, so many years after 2003 Act, which was 2001 Act, if you remember first, we have a contradiction. Kerala does not want open access. It's very interesting. The reason they don't want open access is because their revenue is coming from a set of consumers whom they think will migrate. On the other hand, you have other states which have allowed substantial open access. So at the same time, you did mention that competition is not necessarily a very good idea in all situations. So while we are sitting here in Goa discussing this issue, and you very rightly said that it's a decision that has to be taken by the political bosses. But I'm wondering, with you and the time that you spent in the Ministry of Power and all of us, you know, working on this, what do you think we did wrong in the Electricity Act 2003? And what is it that we need to do to get efficiency? We've got the transmission efficiency down, distribution efficiency down, inefficiency down to a very good level. But what is missing is consumer choice. What is missing is options. Everything is still a very, this thing. So how do you see this panning out in future? I mean, I'm posing this to you because you left your last remark saying that competition is not necessarily the best thing. So I'm sure you have some answers as to maybe some kind of a dictatorship would be very good.
No, I think then I didn't make myself clear enough. I was not saying competition is not a good thing. What I'm saying is that you can have a simplistic view of competition by separation of carriage and content, where there are two difficulties. One, if the carriage is not robust enough, and the other problem is a slightly bigger problem, that separation of carriage and content has worked well in mature markets of the West, where load is not rising substantially. So the demand is roughly flat. Now here, if demand is to rise at 8, 10, 12, 14% per annum, and if competition in generation, which is where you get the maximum benefit, is to come about through competitive procurement by DISCOMs, then if that competitive procurement process ends, then you're looking at capacity addition only through merchant power plants, which may or may not be such a good idea for a country at this stage of development. So the Electricity Act 2003 envisaged competition in generation and understood that the wires business, both transmission and distribution, were natural monopolies, so could remain so, but gave opening for private entry and competitive entry into both transmission and distribution. And it also provided for open access. And in some parts, this has moved. Now, if you were to ask me as to what went wrong with the LXT Act, I wouldn't say that anything went wrong in the LXT Act. The only thing is that law cannot be a substitute for a political consensus and for political evolution. So we cannot legislate political change, and I think it's not a good idea to try and do it.
You see, the 2003 Act had the basic premise that the regulator will eliminate cross-subsidy. In 2005, under the pressure from the left parties, word was substituted, eliminated, it will be reduced. That was the political compromise made. But the reality remains is that, that's why I gave in the beginning this example. Again, I'm repeating, I think, Harry, you were not here. In Maharashtra, 16,000 consumers, they are all HT consumers, they contribute 23,000 crore revenue. You have 2 crore 10 lakh consumers, they contribute 21 lakh revenue, 21,000 crore. Total budget of MSEDCL is 55,000 crore. So can you allow these consumers, only 16,000 consumers, to go away who are contributing 23,000? Now, unless you can address this issue, so problem with the 2003 Act was that it assumed that such a situation would not be there. The tariffs will be such increase, and that's not possible. Now, coming to the agriculture, you face a much serious problem. Because in Maharashtra, the first time MERC raised the tariff for agriculture to 1 rupee 20 paisa. This was from 60 paisa, 1 rupee 20 paisa. And the entire cabinet was asking, can we not add more members to MERC? They say, obviously, then they could control MERC. So this is a very political issue. So let's face that. No? So you are very asking, anyway, I think we'll have a question.
I'll just make one slight comment. The electricity policy of 2005, when we saw that by 2012, cross-subsidy would be within a band of plus minus 20%. In 2015, we are nowhere near that. And then many regulators said that the tariff policy is not binding, it's only one element we'll take into account as we take decisions, et cetera, et cetera. And again, a refresher of memory, there was a regulator, Mr. Rao, I think, in Andhra, who took the law before the LXT Act 2003 very seriously and gave what he thought were tariffs reflecting costs. And then he was gheraud and so on and so forth, and thereafter, I think, other regulators have been far more cautious.
No, actually, what happened in Andhra is more interesting. After that, when that cross-subsidy surcharge was calculated, the methodology developed by Rao was so interesting that actually, if you took open access, you had to pay more, much more than what you are paying today. So right from the Avivineshu, it was a non-starter.
Yes, sir, I am Anand Kumar. I am representing Meghalaya. I'm a regulator in Meghalaya, sir. In most of the presentation, I saw that you refer to regulatory reforms and said that there should be tariff reform. The tariff should be cost reflective. Even the law also says the tariff should be cost reflective. Now, I would like to share my concern with the participant and the who are here that in spite of regulatory initiatives or intervention, like my experience, what I had in Meghalaya, in 4 years, I passed 5 tariff order, and all before 31st March, with a tariff rise of about 8 to 9% every year. Now the revenue, what they are earning, it is now being doubled. The issue is that the regulator is allowing those costs which is prudent. Now the major issue is the AT&C losses, the T&D losses. Now as a regulator, I made a trajectory for them that, okay, you have to reduce the losses by about 1 to 1.5% every year. Now what happened? The result is that there was no improvement in the losses. Now, you have said that there should be accountability. Now, what happened that the tariff is reflective only the portion which we had allowed. Means, suppose I have allowed them 20% losses, but their actual losses is suppose 30%. So there would be a gap, and that gap would be reflected in your financial statement of accounts. So in spite of, you know, regulatory reforms and everything we are talking of, the crux of the problem is the losses. If we do not control the losses, then there will be no, you know, reforms in the country or in any state. That is my experience. I do not know if you want to give an...
Hello.
So there are two issues which come to my mind which contribute to this. One is the gap between communication between the regulator and the utility, and the trust deficit which was talked about of regulator in utility. And the second is the political interference. Because I don't think any regulator by choice would not want to achieve the targets which are given to them. So that's my view.
Yeah. Good afternoon. My name is Gopal Chiksena. My question is addressed to the entire panel. I'm talking in the context of the last 25 years, where from the first IPP policy that was announced in 1991, to now the proposed amendments of Carriage and Content to largely set the tone, and where we talked of the successive phases of privatization, franchisee, whatever, which have never been successful in one sense of the word. Three aspects which need to be deliberated upon. How do you reduce the aspect of the cross-subsidy, which Mr. Ajay Shankar referred to? Because unless you bring in cross-subsidy down, you are going to have a problem on mixed feeders. And Carriage and Content can never get going in that context. And most of our feeders are cross-feeders. The second is that when you come to a situation of being able to reduce cross-subsidy down to 20%, for instance, the issue is how do you make content free? Because you can put a band on it. But then the people with marginal paying capacity, the incumbent licensee is going to have a huge problem servicing his own requirement. And the third problem, which I think is very important, is how do you plan for power procurement? These are three challenges which we have raised several occasions, and yet I don't see any light at the end of the day. Thank you.
Babu Babel, my company runs a retail business in England, probably the only Indian company running. We have 400,000 customers in England supplying gas and electricity. When you're talking about Carriage and Content separation and you talk about mature markets, I think one basic fallacy is when you talk about an open market, the tariff is decided by the retailer. Are we prepared to do that in India? That the retailer would decide the tariff, number one. Number two, the wholesale risk that we're talking about, we've heard from the morning the wholesale risk seems to be enormous. This will add to the complexity when you decide tariff and unknown wholesale risk. Third important thing is the, on losses. Wheeling charges, or what is called distribution user system charges in England, will be a small percentage, whereas the losses are much higher. So the revenue of the wires company will go down, and the losses would be pretty significant. Number four, who will own the meters and who will manage them? Because that's a very important element in that, and who will provide that service. And other more important part is, we talked about all this, where is the customer education going on here? About what ails power sector and who's educating the customer?
What's your question?
So my question is, how are we framing policies here? All the major contributors are here. Power producer, distribution companies, regulators. How does the voice go to the government who formed the policy, and this is then added, or is a suo moto decision taken about a policy and then a decision is taken?
I don't think we are that disorganized as a nation, but Mr. Mehta can perhaps give a nice anecdote on how government hears.
Mr. Mehta talked about next life, so I'm hoping my next
don't
life.
Don't worry, he'll talk about this one too. Mehta sahab, please respond. Ki sarkar decisions kaise leti hai?
the decision-making process is very transparent and fair. The problem is after the decision is made, the implementation, how do you appropriate responsibility? Somewhere I think that line has been diluted between the political leadership and the bureaucracy. The bureaucracy is trying to now encroach upon the political space, and the political space is trying to encroach upon the bureaucracy. A bureaucracy strongly feels, nahi, 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 cross-subsidize mat karo. Free electricity nahi dena. Is that your role? No. That is for the politician to decide. Let him decide. If he thinks nahi, sabko free bijli deni hai, toh sabko free bijli. Just tell him kaise de sakte hai, ya nahi de sakte hai. That's where the whole confusion is coming. And then what we try to do is, the politician has said something, and then we try to invent ways of skirting that. So it's not basically decision-making process that is a problem. The problem is that we try to find a solution which goes around the problem. Or finally we say, yeah, ye problem to hai and nobody can solve it. Let's only discuss in seminars and forget about it.
You understand the Indian ingenuity? Brilliant.
Last
minds.
Question. Hari,
yeah, of course. Please. Please identify yourself, sir. You're not working? IIT professor, you're not working. I say sound management, you better wake up, huh? We're all highly sensitive to this.
Yeah, this is Anoop Singh from IIT Kanpur. I'd like to take forward from what just the previous gentleman from the audience he has. See, who is going to be most influenced by reforms? There are two big political class stakeholders. One is consumers, other is the employees. And these are the two stakeholders. We never sold the reform. If it happened somewhere in UK or any other country, I happened to meet some of the people who were there in the electric grid in UK. The employees were informed through newsletters every fortnightly, every month, what was happening to their company, why it is being done. Similarly, consumers were informed through a variety of things. In our case, we never sold it. We never tried to tell the consumer. So now there is a trust deficit that if you are going to set up a meter, I know next time mujhe bill bhejoge to meter bhi mat lagao. So that's what we're trying to, we have earned that reputation. Today, if we have to learn something about any kind of choice I'm available in telecom, do I need to go to a telecom company or telecom minister? No, the local guy, he is so friendly, I'll ask him how many tariff things are there and please give me the best one. I really feel we have failed there. Apart from all the problems they are there, we never sold the reform to these two important stakeholders. And that's the reason it's not becoming a success.
But isn't that in itself a reform, the local guy? Yes, JDK. You want to respond? Sir, anyone, please. I want to interfere in the panel. Most welcome to react if you want.
I'm JD Kulkarni, editor Power Watch.
We can't see you. We want to see you. So good looking.
I'm JD Kulkarni, editor Power Watch magazine. I just have a simple question. You know, I've been told that DISCOMs are making losses and.
Hold on, before you ask that question, I must tell the audience, JDK is ex-startup power for the last 35 years. Now he's asking the question. Yes, sir. Shoot.
Sorry. So the question was, if the DISCOMs are making losses, most of the losses I was told by these DISCOMs are because of the interest burden from the banks, PFC, REC, whatever it is. Now, is it true that it is major portion of it is because of the interest? And if it is an interest, RECs, PFC and banks, everybody is in a profit. So I just wanted to know whether it is true, anybody either from the dais or otherwise if you can explain it to me.
You see, the reason is very simple. Yes. If you take Rajasthan, for 5 years they did not have tariff revision. Now you will wonder, how could a utility function if there were no tariff revision? It was a very happy situation. The banks were giving them short-term loan. So every year, used to return the loan, take higher loan, banks were being paid interest, and that's how there is a 12 to 13% is the interest rate. This is all the accumulated. This is the situation. Similar thing is in Tamil Nadu, and that's what has happened. So that entire FRP scheme was that the state government will take 50% of that loan, they will issue bonds, 50% banks will be asked to adjust. But what has happened is that even that adjustment has not taken place. So we are again back to that. See, again, one of the things about this decision making, see, the federal system, what has happened is the Electricity Act 2003, Ajay Shankar, they did go to states, they discussed it, But reality is that since I was Secretary of Energy in Maharashtra, I don't think in Maharashtra anybody really understood what that legislation in 2003 was.
We're working on it, sir. We're still trying.
That's the interesting thing. Right. And now, when it comes to the new amendments, I don't think the states have understood really what the carriage and content is. But only one thing is that they were always alarmed. So they told the standing committee of the parliament that it's too early to do this. Give us 5 years. After 5 years, we'll do it. So that's why the amendment, they have made the change. After 5 years, we'll take a call. So that's where we are matters.
My question was different.
Sorry, go ahead.
What I'm saying is, if it is majorly because of the interest burden which we are talking about, is the government taking it from one pocket and giving it to the another pocket? Is it only because of the interest burden, or it's really a issue? That's all I want to ask.
Can I just react to that? There's a recent article you must read, which tells you that Greece, which has gone bankrupt, had a debt of 148% of its GDP. Japan, which has almost 300% of its GDP, is not bankrupt. So it's all about management of debt, if that helps you address your concern. Management of how you manage your finance. So borrowing money is a good idea, but also how you manage the borrowing and how you flow it around. As he said, you repay and you make your repayments and then it floats. That's what it is. Okay, we're running out of time, guys.
Like I made in my presentation, the things are very clear. Like if the sector is incurring a loss of 70,000 crores, either it can come from consumer or it can come from the government revenues. You see, the sector has to sustain and further if you want to make further progress, further investment to have come. Now, ultimately, whatever comes from the government kitty is also your money only. It comes to the taxpayer only from a selected people. So, you have to balance it out. And the Electricity Act provided upfront that the government wants to subsidize a particular section, they are free to do it and you pay upfront subsidy. So, I think that balance
whether
you want to do it from the government route or you want to do the consumer route.
No, see, government cannot do it with the state government. I got the Fiscal Responsibility Act. So they're
restricted.
4% is the limit. Otherwise, their overdrawal rather will be stopped. So that's why it's much easier to pass it on to the DISCOM, that they should do it.
So one of the reasons, Mr. Kulkarni, is that this concept of regulatory asset is a huge burden on the consumer. He uses that money to put in a deposit, assuming that the low-end consumer is only in the saving deposit. He gets 4%, 5%, 6%, whereas the same is being funded by the corporations to be recovered from him at maybe 10, 12, 15%. That's a huge, huge burden.
But sir, all those corporations are in profit. That's the only...
What do you mean by profit?
Most of them are...
It's going to the bankers in the system, you see?
Okay.
Guys, I know this is going out of control. No, sir, I'm sure you do, but I'm sorry. I have to put the guillotine here. I want to just make an announcement. We have with us, amongst us, a very, very important person, the Power Minister for Karnataka, Mr. D.K. Shiv Kumar. May I just request him to just come up for 2 minutes? Sir, may we request you just come up for 2 minutes? And you need to release our knowledge report, sir. We want you to release our knowledge report. It's right here next to you. Please, sir, we won't take more than 2 minutes for that. Okay, he's going to release the knowledge report that we put together for this event. Sir, if you could kindly open one, we'd be very happy. So would you like to say a few words, or you're happy as you are? Two words. How can a politician say not say anything?
Good afternoon to all of you. I'm very happy to be here. this association is helping the government, the country, the consumer. So on behalf of a part of being a government of Karnataka, I would like to congratulate the stakeholders, because I believe joining together is the beginning. Thinking together is the progress. Working together is the success. I'm sure you all are working for the success of this great nation. I don't like to much speak much on any issue today. Normally politicians are, they take a lot of time on speaking. They are born out of speaking. You normally speak more. But let me tell you, country is progressing, but we are on crossroads. Lot of issues has to be corrected among ourselves. Though the Western countries are giving us lot of ideas, but India is such a nation, still we have to depend on various subsidies. I think you remember last when UPA government was there, Manmohan Singh has to give us way of about 72,000 crores on the farmers, a very huge burden. But it is a political decision. So every governments which in power, either in the states or in the center, lot of soups, lot of issues have been given to who this to seek the voters. But again, from Karnataka, I think I was just hearing to the discussion what was going on. 39% of the power has been given to farmers. We have about 9,500 megawatt capacity, and 7,000 to 8,000 crores has been given as a subsidy to the farmers. So this is the situation. Still, I am trying to convince the farmer, trying to tell them the value of power, what is the cost within them. If definitely, governments have to help the farmers, but at the same time, we have to bring out a situation, all of us have to join, to teach them, to educate them the value of this power, because all of you are working for a paisa, two paisa, three paisa, to see that at least this industry feels more stronger. Anyway, let me hear. I can spend still 2-3 hours time on this issue. I come here to show my solidarity. You all are giving a better direction, and especially in the last meeting, I think on this same, I was in Bangalore on this content and carriage. Even in my minister's conference, the first conference, I just bluntly said my country's minister, whose dynamic you could understand, that Karnataka opposes to it, and you will have to have a rethink on this entire issue. I think now, as one of my panelists was telling, that it has been taken 5 years holiday. So naturally, I think in this country, it is very difficult because there is a different section. The entire farming sector and the subsidies, the soups, still we stop that. We can't take such decisions. Only the carriage, only the carrot will be picked. Important cities will be picked. I think even there, lot of very big business industry, businessmen have failed in this sector. Anyway, let me not go into the detail. Once again, I wish you a great success. Lot of things should come. A message should go out. You should help the government, help the industry, and see that all of us are in the power with 24/7. Thank you. Thank you one and all.
Amazing panel, guys. Come on. All the stars are here. Kya applause mila sir. Okay, is it tea break time? No tea break, sorry. The dictator, the great dictator says no tea break. Next panel, please. So we've moved now from, I don't know where we moved actually. We were in the morning, we were talking about philosophy and now we're in content and carriage. Okay. All right, there's a parallel workshop happening on smart grids at level poolside near the breakfast hall in Govapuri Hall by Schneider. Those of you who are participating, please do so if you feel like it. Otherwise, enjoy the next session. Can I have your program? No, got a copy. Thanks. May I call the panelists for the next session, please? Thank you. Do you want me to name them? Mr. Chaturvedi? Yeah? Yes, of course. Mr. Sukesh Jain, Energy Secretary, Government of Delhi. Mr. Chaturvedi, former Chairman, PA Power Finance Corporation. Mr. Roy, Reliance Transmission. Mr. Negi, MD Getco. Ravi Arya, President, Hindustan Power. T.R. Shankar Raman, Scientist, Nature Conservation Foundation. Mr. Vikas Dabir, Director of Business Development, Applied Materials, Private Limited. I'm so sorry. Chaturvedi Saab was Chairman of Power Grid. May I now ask somebody to chair the session? Who's willing to chair? Who's? Chaturvedi's name is printed as chairman. Chaliye, Chaturvedi sahab, aap lag jaiye. Shuru kijiye. Chair it and don't give more than 5 minutes to anybody.
Thank you. This session is also a very important session because this will discuss about the transmission, which is the biggest link between generator and the distributor. Since morning we are hearing that there are a lot of problems in power sector, particularly from the private sector producers, transmission was singularly cited as one of the bottleneck. But I must tell you, although I was chairman of Power Grid Corporation, now a regulator, but my role here is as a chairman and moderator, so I will not speak much about the conditions from where and from which state the transmission has evolved and a great revolution took place in this country over a period of 20, 25 years. It's a big topic for discussions. But the mandate given to us today is that transmission issues present for short term, long term, and medium term possible solutions. As far as transmission is concerned, not the distribution, I can definitely say that not a single unit has been blocked due to non-availability of transmission system. The transmission system is robust. Power can be taken from one part of the country to other, any state, and a lot of developments are being made, such as recently the operator has been separated under the name of POSOCO. Number two, superhighways are being commissioned regularly for carrying bulk power. The capacity of carrying power has also been increased. And for information, the latest line of Power Grid Corporation from Vishwanath Chariali to Agra has got one single line which carries 6,000 megawatt of power, not less than that, 6,000 megawatt on single transmission line. Now, most of the panelists, fortunately, have worked with me, but now they are on the other side of the table. So I have got a difficult task to choose, because we will be discussing issues from both sides of the table. So starting from the state side, I will request Mr. Negi to start. What are his issues and how he feels about the transmission?
Good afternoon, dignities on the dais, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, sir, for inviting me first. I have been in transmission for the last 35 years, but this sector always remain amazing and always a surprising package for me throughout my career. We have discussed enough philosophy and losses and financial conditions of the DISCOMs. That is the reality. But I will not go into that. I will go to the real technicalities and transmission development in the country, challenges, issues. There is nothing like short-term, long-term, and medium-term in transmission, sir. My feeling is that generation and we have been brother to both generation and the distribution. We are the bridge between them. And then there is a government as a godfather. And we have been always actually swinging between these two utilities and have been really attending, addressing, handling the issues which have come time to time. I will take you to history of that little bit and then address the issue of challenges and issues with us today. Generation, when I talk of generation, first thing we have to, in transmission, is a good business. It has got a good returns, and that's why privatization has been to some extent successful. State, it has not been. That is a different subject. I think Mr. Alok will cover that. But in case of a generation, there was a time when too many power plants came into picture, and there has been robust regulatory mechanism of transmission, the transmission planning, rules and regulation, everything was in place. In 2007, somewhere it was felt that transmission has to take a big leap, jump, and generations are coming and transmission will bottleneck. That time, a lot of discussion took place, and we being a stakeholder of the state in the standing committee have to approve the transmission network. And you know, without the beneficiary identification, we cannot PPA, we cannot sign that, we can transmit tariff. But we were compelled that time, and as a one of the part of the approving the transmission network as a Gujarat state, we agreed that we will do the system. We agreed that we will put up a transmission system without even the private players identifying the beneficiaries and without identifying the reason. And then we have a law which regulation has come through the regulation that connectivity. I think there was a big flaw in that we had to give connectivity, and then later on he will identify the beneficiaries, and up to 500 megawatt, about 500 megawatt, I had to give connectivity. You know, very progressive step taken by transmission at that time, looking into the situation of the generation capacity coming, rushing in that point of time. So transmission has been acting according to its to the need of the dynamics of the market. Though there is a clear transmission planning, network planning, national plan, everything is available, and utilities have been acting according to that. There has been some gaps between in the infrastructure, interstate transmission network as far as that is concerned. But you know what happened now? See, having done transmission line, now today we are in a situation where again transmission has to struggle, you know, and when there is a power available and we have a capacity to about 280 gigawatt. And today if you see any time in the system operator, you will find 140 or 150 megawatt. Where is the rest of the capacity? Now states are not taking, they prefer to be not to supply power to the consumer to go into further losses. Now again, transmission is trouble here. Now what happens, at the same time, power is becoming cheaper, and the power is becoming cheaper, now people are going for open access. Now people are going for open access. Again, transmission is become a scapegoat. that you have not given enough network. I say that I don't develop a transmission network to address short-term open access. The short-term, if today, if the market has become 2.5 rupees a unit, power is available. I cannot be culprit stating that I am not having enough network. I don't develop for that. So transmission now today has is a big challenge, that it has a particular state who are denying open access. And in the let me tell you very openly, and Kerala has very told very openly, that DISCOMs now, we being a brother of the DISCOMs, and we have to safeguard, because at the end of the day, whole transmission system in the state with crores of rupees has been established with the money of the consumer and the DISCOM. So today, that again issue of this transmission system comes, and then we regulator says that you please develop a network. Give me a target of next 3 years that you will develop a network which will address to the facilitation of the short-term open access. Again, I will say this is the call of the market, compelling transmission system to now develop a network. Now, what is emerging to all that? It is all emerging to a GNA. In the last year, this topic was very general network access. It was discussed here. Now, like carrier content, what we discussed here, again, government is trying to push GNA. Now, GNA, you know, anything in the country is okay, good for the country, but we have to think whether it is implementable or not. See, like even in the policy, our act says that above 1 megawatt open access is allowed. Now, this was there in right from the act itself, but suddenly one fine morning government says, no, it has to be implemented, and they forced us to start implementing it.
2003 was.
We're working on it, sir. We're still trying.
That's the interesting thing. Yeah. And now, when it comes to the new amendments, I don't think the states have understood really what the carriage and content is. But only one thing is that they were always alarmed. So they told the standing committee of the parliament that it's too early to do this. Give us 5 years. After 5 years, we will do it. So that's why the amendment they have made the change. After 5 years, we'll take a call. So that's where we are matters.
My question was different.
Sorry, go ahead.
What I'm saying is, if it is majorly because of the interest burden which we are talking about, is the government taking it from one pocket and giving it to the another pocket? I mean, is it only because of the interest burden, or it's really a issue? That's all I want to ask.
Can I just react to that? There's a recent article you must read, which tells you that Greece, which has gone bankrupt, had a debt of 148% of its GDP. Japan, which has almost 300% of its GDP, is not bankrupt. So it's all about management of debt, if that helps you address your concern.
I mean,
management of how you manage your finance. So borrowing money is a good idea, but also how you manage the borrowing and how you flow it around, as he said, you know, you repay and you make your repayments and then it floats. That's what it is. Okay, we're running out of time, guys.
Like I made in my presentation, the things are very clear. Like if the sector is incurring a loss of 70,000 crores, I mean, either it can come from consumer or it can come from the government revenues. You see, the sector has to sustain, and further, if you want to make further progress, further investment to have come. Now, I mean, ultimately, whatever comes from the government kitty is also your money only. It comes to the taxpayer only from a selected people. So, I mean, you have to balance it out. I mean, and the Electricity Act provided upfront that the government wants to subsidize a particular section, they are free to do it, and you pay upfront subsidy. So, I think that balance
but
has to be
do that, no, sir.
Whether you want to do it from the government route or you want to do the consumer route.
No, see, government cannot do it with the state government. I got the Fiscal Responsibility Act. So they're
restricted.
4% is the limit. Otherwise, their overdrawal rather will be stopped. So that's why it's much easier to pass it on to the DISCOM, that they should do it.
So one of the reasons, Mr. Kulkarni, is that this concept of regulatory asset is a huge burden on the consumer. He uses that money to put in a deposit, assuming that the low-end consumer is only in the saving deposit. He gets 4%, 5%, 6%, whereas the same is being funded by the corporations to be recovered from him at maybe 10, 12, 15%. That's a huge, huge burden.
But sir, all those corporations are in profit. I mean, that's the only...
Do you mean by profit?
I mean, most of them are...
It's going to the bankers in the system, you see?
Okay.
Guys, I know this is going out of control. No, no, I'm sure you do, but I'm sorry. I have to put the guillotine here.